structure, we look at the interaction with a simple model of a complex viscoelastic fluid. And for that, we're going to look at the continuum description of the dumbbell model that Mike talked about last week. So this slide was prepared by Mike in PowerPoint. I am showing it to you in Keynote because have any of you had the problem where PowerPoint just explodes on that? Yeah, so most of the time you could just show it in Keynote, but then once and again you get these funny kind of glitches here, like your dots become X's and all
that. I would take a different lesson from that fact and maybe do it, whether you should have bought a Mac.
No, I should just prepare the talk in Keynote before I make my own slides. Anyway, so here we're going to look at the Stokes equations, and so we have no inertial terms. The Stokes equations with an external forcing, and you should think about this external forcing as being this delta function layer of force that we talked about that transmits forces from an elastic structure to the surrounding fluid. But on top of this, we've got forces due to the polymer stress field. Okay, and so this is non-dimensionalized. The Weisenberg number represents the ratio of time scales, the relaxation time of the polymers to the time scale of the fluid. So if the Weisenberg number was zero, then we would have the Stokes equations. And here we've got the advection of the stress field. This is a tensor. And here, Weisenberg number, this is the upper convective derivative. And right now in this formulation, we don't have any stress diffusion. Okay, so what we want to do is to now think about this, an inverse boundary implementation of the Stokes-Oldred-B equations. And so you recognize I have a schematic like this before. In a Newtonian fluid, we will have some configuration, and that will give rise to some forcing F, and this is where all the modeling and biology and whatever comes in. We want to somehow transmit that to the surrounding fluid, and we want to solve the Navier-Stokes-Oldred-B system. What we have to do differently here, a couple of things. So I have Navier-Stokes, and I'll show you some results from Navier-Stokes-Oldred-B where we include inertial terms. But what we also have to do is to advect the polymer stress. Now, I'm going to go back. My notation is really bad. I'm going back and forth between S and sigma, and it might even have other words. But this is just an advection equation. And then once we solve for that, we go back, interpolate group velocity, and so forth. So let's see what we have. So here, this is courtesy of Joey Turan and Charlie Peskin, where this is just a Stokes solver. And what you're seeing here are two circles being pushed through the fluid and then pushed back. And the Reynolds number, much, much less than one, are fluid tracers. And you see that the movie was not played backwards. This was part of the simulation and the calculation. And you see that, you see the reversibility. I think the contours are vorticity contours just for visual appeal. Okay. To illustrate that the same thing is not true, here we're solving the same system of taking these knobs and moving them around and then pushing them back, and Reynolds number much, much less than one are fluid tracers. And what you see is that when we go through the cycle and return these pegs to the original position, the fluid tracers are not. And you can stare at this for a long time and decide what this looks like to you. I think it looks like two faces looking at each other. And what the color contours are showing is the trace of the stress tensor, which shows how much the polymers are distended locally. So one other thing that's, like I said last time, one of the classical problems in biofluids, besides swimming filaments, is looking at peristaltic pumping. And you can think about this for a while, that the two problems are very much related. And I, in either case, if you, you know, the classical peristaltic pumping is you have a channel. Let's think about this in 2D. You have a channel along which you pass a sinusoidal wave. And here in this picture, we have the wave going in this direction. As you pass a wave in this direction, you tend to pump fluid in that direction. You don't pump it uniformly. In the contracted sections, you will have some flow reversal and so forth. So waves of contraction moving to the right move, transport fluid to the right. So this, again, a classical biofluids problem back in the 60s and 70s, there are asymptotic solutions for flow rates based on long wavelength theory, small amplitude, Stokes flow, and so on. So what we sought to do, and we is Joey Turan at UCLA and Mike, we said, what happens now? Let's look at this classical problem, but instead look at pumping of not a Newtonian Stokes fluid, but a Stokes Ulgroid B fluid. And will we see similar things? And so actually, we see two main departures from Newtonian pumping. Reversibility no longer holds, and I'll show you some interesting result there. And also, the pumping efficacy does not increase with the occlusion ratio. So you imagine that you have a tube filled with liquid, and you're going to pass a contraction along it, pumping fluid. You would imagine that the more you contract it, the more fluid that you would transport, your flow rate would increase. So in fact, here is what happens with the occlusion ratio. The occlusion ratio of one would mean that the tube is completely occluded, that the top wall would touch down on the bottom wall. Okay. So here I'm showing you mild occlusion rate, very mild occlusion ratios to half occlusion ratio. And so let's look at a few things. This dotted blue line that is occluded by the green line is the an asymptotic solution in the Newtonian Stokes flow by Jaffrin. So this, for you peristalsis aficionados, the original work by Shapiro et al. Looked at long wavelength theory and did not take into account the curvature of the walls. Jaffrin later improved this by looking at by including terms that captured the curvature. So what you see is that for the Stokes computation, Weisenberg number equals zero, the computations actually match dead on with the theory. And here's my other preaching aside point. No matter what we're doing in computational fluids and all of these models, it's really important and valuable to have some test problems. I don't think I need to really tell you this, but lots of, if you have asymptotic solutions and your computations can match that regime, that gives you confidence to go forward. Of course, going forward when you're adding more complications, that doesn't mean you're right then. Even if you don't have a closed form solution, you want to do convergence studies and other things to be sure that your calculations are right. So a lot of things in this business are also looking for good test problems. So it's especially in especially when you start looking at complex fluids, there really aren't any nice known closed form or asymptotic solutions. So when you find one, treasure it and use that. Okay, so what's happening here? Here is occlusion ratio. As the amplitude goes up and the occlusion ratio goes up, the pumping, this is the mean flow in the direction of the wave, increases. But so what you see is then as we increase the Weisenberg number, for a while we get this increase. But for a more viscoelastic fluid, where elasticity is more important, at some point, the tube for larger occlusion ratios is not pumping as well. And what's happening here? These polymers have a longer relaxation time. As the fluid gets pumped, they're getting extended, they're exerting a lot of force, and they're clogging up the tube in some way. So you see here for Weisenberg number 2 and 5, up to a certain occlusion ratio, you get an increase in pumping, and then you see dramatic fall off. So this is something that is completely different from the Newtonian case. Okay, and so that's quite interesting. The dynamics changes completely. Let's look at this. So here is, let's look at fluid mixing and so forth. So here, if you look along the first row, I'll tell you what it is. So just focus on the first row. And here what we did is this Stokes flow. Pass a wave in this direction for one period, and then you reverse it, pass the wave back. So as you would expect in Stokes flow, here are the initial fluid particles. Here's after one second, which is one temporal period, and you see here you get some mixing, and then you pass the wave back in that direction, and the fluid markers, by and large, except for some numerical noise, fall back where they started. But now let's do this, and I believe this is Weisenberg number 1 or 5, I'm not sure. But let's do this repeatedly in a viscoelastic fluid, where we pass away, pass it back, pass away, pass it back. So here, time 0, time 1, time 2, you see even at time 2 things are not quite back where they are, and we do this through 5 cycles of back and forth at t equal 10, you see that you have this tongue of markers going in that direction. So this suggests that viscoelastic mixing may be enhanced, well, mixing may be enhanced when your fluid is not Newtonian. So there are lots of interesting issues with mixing in microfluidic devices, and at low Reynolds number flow, sometimes one has to rely on Taylor diffusion to get particles mixed. Maybe this suggests that if the fluid being used is viscoelastic, you might get some more mixing.
It's increasing Weisenberg number on the way down.
No, I'm sorry. This is one simulation, and this is another. So this is Weisenberg 0, and these 6 are Weisenberg 5, I think.
Okay, yeah, no, that's what I meant. Could you, I'm maybe everyone else, I'm the Weisenberg number, is there some, any sort of qualitative thing that is captured by that number? I'm trying to wrap my brain around some sort of qualitative thing that these numbers can do.
It is it's a non-dimensional quantity that tells you the ratio of 2 time scales, the relaxation time of these polymers. So remember when Mike talked about the Oldroyd B model, at every point in space there's some concentration of teeny tiny dumbbell springs. And when these little these dumbbell springs are hooking, and when they get stretched, they want to contract back. When the Weisenberg number is bigger, the elastic forces due to these dumbbells are bigger. If there was zero, if the Weisenberg number were 0, if you had 0 relaxation time, you would feel no force due to these little teeny tiny springs wanting to contract. So that tells you more or less the extent of the elasticity and the viscoelasticity of the fluid.
Becca, at the slide that you just shown, it looked like in the middle there was some sort of steady state. There's like some sort of steady state flow, and you can see like the yellow moving off to the right and the bottom right.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like the only thing that's taking you out of the direction is the fact that the first time step you go one way as opposed to the other. Which seems
well, you
kind
go
of,
one way, the other way, one way, the other
right, way. Right, no, and it looks like after, you know, after five cycles, in the middle, there's sort of a flow that's
you
building
do,
up.
It actually does fall into a steady state, so you're right.
Right, so my question is, it seems like the only thing that can possibly pick out a direction, you know, going to the right, is the first time step.
That's right.
That
so
seems really strange,
right.
Because if you do this for infinity, then you have this steady state flow that's completely dependent on the first time step that was so long ago.
But what I'm not showing here is that you do get a steady state flow, but it's not as if you take it and you reflect it that it's the same.
Right, but this is particle displacement. So it's not showing the stresses. Right? So you're moving here, then you're moving that, moving here, moving that, moving here, moving that. And so there's a complete bias in the sense that you're looking at particle displacement from t equals zero where they're all lined up and they just displace over. So there's a very strong direction picked initially in particle displacement because you set up the initial data. It's kind of a different thing from saying that you know, there might be some bias eventually in the polymer stresses. That's different.
I guess I'm just surprised that if you do this, if you continue this on indefinitely, that you're going to continually have a steady state flow in one direction.
You have a steady state flow in both directions. Does that make sense? You get periodic steady state. You
right.
Get,
so yeah. If you just look at the even time steps, right? Then I mean, it looks like if you just look at t equals 1, 2, 8, and 10. There, it looks like they're moving.
Why don't I continue on and show you some movies and it might... But we can come back to it. I'm not stopping this discussion. It's good, but this might shed some light. So, let's see what happens now. Keep it thought. Let's see what happens now if instead of looking at pumping A of a Stokes ovary B fluid, you look at Navier Stokes, but we're still keeping this at lowish Reynolds number. But instead of tracking fluid particles, we're going to track, I'm calling it a solid object. It's not so solid, it's filled with fluid, it's a membrane that has bending rigidity. So it's a circle, it's a cylinder.
Can I just go back to this just for a question? I think I know the answer to your question, if you don't mind. Those simulations start off with an isotropic stress field. So there's no initial stress. So there's a period in which the stress is adapting itself to the periodic forcing and going to some sort of periodic steady state. And so what you're seeing with that little jet is, if you like, it's also the result of that initial relaxation into a quite different state over time. And that gets reflected in that initial kind of tongue of particles that's sticking out. And then over time, you'll see that tongue just sits there and just goes back and forth. So there is some there's some initial data dependence because that initial particle motion was coming from a state of zero stress.
But it forgets that after.
But it forgets
that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you would see that in the Eulerian vector fields that you calculate after some time, rather than fluid markers.
You certainly see it in the fluid markers.
Okay. Good. So we're putting in a solid particle that is filled with fluid. Of course, in all of these immersed boundary calculations, we have the same fluid everywhere, except these membranes are such that extra forces are exerted. Okay. So now we're going to see what happens in that case. So here, I thought maybe this movie will help you. And what you're seeing is the wave being passed to the right, and you're seeing the contours of the stress tensor. Okay, so like Mike said, we're starting out with zero extra stress. So you see what happens, stress builds up where the flow is, where the tube is contracted around the net. You see this particle being transported. We have periodic boundary conditions. The hiccups that you see just in the graphics when the circle moves out versus when it comes back in here. So you see that you get these hot spots in the contracted region. And so the question is, so now does this help you see you were getting some periodic steady state, even with the stresses? But you can ask lots of questions here. For instance, does viscoelasticity enhance or hinder the transport of these particles? You know, one motivation for looking at this is overtransport in the ova duct and uterus, where it has a finite volume and it's not transport. So here are different, you know, here's what the channel would look like with the same stress contour levels for without the particle, same Weisenberg number. And here, trying to tell you, these are just different times. So here, let's see what we get. So actually something interesting happens. In fact, the viscoelasticity does not help particle transport. But if you go back to that movie, you see that what you get with this particle, that's reminiscent of peristaltic pumping, it goes forward, and then when it gets to a contracted region, it goes back a bit, forward, back a bit. But here, if you look at this at this curve that has on the x-axis, this is time, and this is the x position of the centroid of that solid particle. You see that it goes forward in x, back a bit, forward in x, back a bit. This top line is in the Newtonian case. I'll tell you that the Reynolds number is about, I believe, 1 in all these cases. So you see you get forward displacement, and then it gets into that neck region where it's occluded and travels back. Forward, travels back. And then over here, what we have for 4 different Weisenberg numbers, 0.5, 1, 5, and so on. So my Weisenberg number here changed to a lambda. That's what you get when you put pieces of talks together. So what happens in this path? If you look at the movies for a while and you look at this path, the Newtonian particle spends more of its time going in the direction of the wave and less of the time being spit backwards. In the case where you have non-zero Weisenberg number, where you have viscoelasticity, you see that the time that the particle spends going forward is less, and it spends more time being spit backwards. And if you look at the movie again, you can see that this makes sense because that stress field is building up in the contracted region. So now I didn't plot for you Eulerian flow fields, but because of conservation of mass, when most of the flow is going this way, we've got to have some of it going back, and that's happening in the occluded region. So in fact here, when the stress field builds up, it's like having a tighter occlusion, and it's really being pushed back. The velocity in that region is bigger. So these are just some, these are caricature studies. These aren't, full 3D, all the details in here, but just from simple caricature problems like this, you could get some intuition on how things change when you add an elastic component to the flow. So here now I'm going to go back to looking at the swimming problem. So I showed you last time just a vignette of taking our full sperm flagellum model with the diamines and so on, and put it in some meshwork of an elastic fluid. And now, instead, what we want to do is to look at what happens when we put one of these swimming creatures in a Oldroyd B fluid. And what we'd like to do is, in order to isolate the problem and just understand how the viscoelasticity is changing things, we're going to try to prescribe the kinematics. And so we're going to go back to the swimming sheet problem of Light Hill. You know, here, you know, I failed this class. My dot is an X over here. So I know that, I guess Pecco went over the Light Hill swimming sheet problem. And so this, again, is the beginning of biofluids of motility by Light Hill, where he considered the infinite swimming sheet and looked at the undulations along it with a certain amplitude epsilon and computed that the swimming speed goes like epsilon squared in a Stokes fluid. This is 60 plus years, and lots of work has been done on this low Reynolds number problem, including a whole bunch of different computational methodologies. But a few years back, Eric Logo looked at what would happen to the swimming sheet problem when you do the asymptotics and put it in an old red B fluid. And what he found asymptotically is that the moment you add viscoelasticity to the problem, the sheet swims more slowly than if there was no elasticity. So Stokes wins. Okay. So what we wanted to do was to look at what happens not just for a swimming sheet, but for a finite swimmer in such a thing. The swimming sheet problem gives lots of insight, but it has a lot of restrictive symmetry to it. So there could be interesting end effects when you take out some of that symmetry. So let me tell you what you're seeing here. So we're looking at the ratio of the swimming speed of that sheet in a viscoelastic fluid with a fixed Weisenberg number or Deborah number, so using those two terms the same, over the swimming velocity in a Newtonian Stokes fluid. Okay? And so here, for that swimming sheet problem, of course, if the Weisenberg number is zero, the ratio is one. But then the asymptotics falls off like this. Okay? So we compared we thank Eric for having this great test problem, this analytic solution to compare our computations with. And so this, you know, gives you an idea, gives confidence in the numerical algorithm. And you know what you see here is this. So let's take Weisenberg equal to 1. And let's blow this up. And let's look at the swimming speed as a function of time. Again, we're starting out with a uniform, no extra polymer stress. And so these are at different, we look at different amplitudes, and we see that we have some transients as this swimming speed approaches the asymptotic.
Does the dissipation go up or down, or what does it do?
Dissipation of what?
Dissipation of energy in the fluid. Presumably it must be doing work to...
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It goes up with...
How much work you're doing, and how much work the sheet does as a function of Weisenberg number? Do you know?
Well, it turns out by a measure of efficiency, which involves the total power output, there's a peak around Weisenberg equal to 1. So actually,
it's not monotonic.
Okay, so let's look at what happens for the sheet as well.
Oh, just for the sheet.
He's asking about the sheet. I'm not sure, but I know he calculated.
No, I think it's monotonic for the sheet, actually. It's okay. In case you have a free swim, it's a little different.
So, free swim. So now let's look at this and see what happens when we put in a different waveform. So we look at something that's not an infinitely long constant amplitude sheet. We look at a finite swimmer, still 2D. And we look at a particular type of waveform where the amplitude at the tail is larger. We are not looking at a C. elegans type of waveform where there is uniform amplitude or amplitude pretty much the same at the head region as the tail. We are looking more like a spermatozoa waveform where the amplitude is enhanced in the tail region. And we see something very interesting happening. Now, what we're showing you in this picture here are, here's the filament. The arrows on the filament show you which way the filament is moving at that instant. But these ellipses are a nice way of visualizing the stress field. So the stress tensor, or the stress field. The stress tensor is a symmetric 2x2 matrix. It has real positive eigenvalues, symmetric positive definite, and it has orthogonal eigenvectors. And the ellipsoids that we're drawing here are oriented in the direction of the eigenvectors, and the aspect ratio is the ratio of the eigenvalues. So the ellipsoid is telling you how a local patch of polymers are being distended instantaneously. So we see that this is not a symmetric problem, and at the tail region, we have this clump of gunk, and that's a technical term. So we see that there's this viscoelastic stretched springs that it has to encounter at every beat. Just like the peristaltic pumping case where the particle went forward, back, if you look at a swimming filament, even the infinite sheet, if you look at a material point, as the wave goes by, the x position of that material point does not monotonically go forward in the direction of swimming. You do have this forward-back motion, forward-back, in all cases. Infinite sheet, finite sheet, Newtonian, non-Newtonian. But what we found in this swimmer is that when the swimmer would go forward and then back a bit, the amount that it went back was, for some Weisenberg numbers, hindered by this jump behind it. So it would go forward, but it wouldn't go back as far if we looked at that. So here's a movie that Joey Turan did where we're visualizing the stress field as these ellipsoids. And let me tell you what the upshot is. So let's just look at this blue curve here. So this is for the fixed kinematics of the swimmer. And this swimmer, it's not set in stone. We are using stiffness constants to have this achieve a prescribed curvature. And our stiffness constants are tuned large enough that we by and large get the prescribed shape that we want. But here, as a function for that particular geometry, as a function of Weisenberg number, we look at the ratio of the swimming speed of this creature over the ratio in a Stokes fluid, in a Stokes Newtonian fluid. And what you see is that at Weisenberg number one, we achieve a maximum. So where's one here? Here's the number one. So for a range of Weisenberg numbers tuned to where the time scale of the forcing of the flagellum is about equal to the time scale of the relaxation of the polymers, we actually get an enhanced swimming speed. And I can't really see this. Actually, this is one. I'm sorry. What I told you before was false. This is one. So we get about a 30% increase when the forcing of the fluid is on par with the relaxation time of the immersed polymers. So there are a few lessons to be learned from this, that you can get great intuition and understanding from the swimming sheet problem, yes, but we have to get rid of some of the symmetry from that problem to see to get more intuition on what's going on. Now, I am not at all delusional. This here is lovely. This is not a real sperm flagellum. Real sperm flagellum have internal motors. They are not two-dimensional, and so on. But we are gaining some intuition here. Yeah.
Can I break some symmetries of the Taylor problem just by using a different waveform? Some other crazy waveform, not a...
Yeah, I mean, this would be something that should be, that could be explored. In fact, when we did these simulations, and we're trying to look at them again, when we did these simulations where we had a finite swimmer but with mostly a constant amplitude, we didn't see this kind of pickup here. And we believe that what's happening is this, what the story that I told you beforehand. So, yeah, looking at other crazy waveforms and so on would be very interesting.
Not only in this, I'm saying in the Taylor sheet problem. In the Taylor problem.
Yeah.
Can I look at crazy waveforms and break some of the symmetries of the problem?
Oh, yeah, sure. I mean, rather than having, as long as it's periodic, but you won't get any of these end effects. No, I'm not. I've spent a good part of my life looking at the Taylor sheet problem, and I've learned an awful lot from it. So I'm not suggesting that you can't do anything within that framework. You can do an awful lot, but I do think that the end effects could be important. Okay, so that's what I wanted to tell you about looking at immersed boundaries within an Oldroyd B setup. And again, this here is just a picture looking at the forward velocity of a single material point from the Stokes versus the Oldroyd B. And here you see the blue is Stokes. There's a time where the velocity is more negative here, but doesn't get that low when you have viscoelasticity. Okay, so this is very much also, this is reminiscent of the peristaltic pumping. So now what, while I have your undivided attention, I want to leave viscoelasticity for a bit and leave the inertial regime, even moderate Reynolds number, and go to regularized Stokes laws. Okay. So let me change my talk here. Are there any questions? Any comments about Oldroyd B? Honestly, it would be nice to have better or other models of viscoelastic fluid. What happened in Oldroyd B, like Mike pointed out, these little polymers never break when they get stretched beyond a certain point. We would want to have one of these Fenny P models or so forth.
Are there experimental tests of these predictions and models in detail? I mean, I know you talked about there's analytic tests.
Well, has anybody...
Can you cook up an old ruby fluid and put the swimmer in there and see if there's stuff in there?
It's easier. I don't think there have been any synthetic swimmers where you could really regulate the waveform. The problem of the experiments with sperm is that they do what they want and the waveforms will change dramatically. So, has anybody synthesized something close to an Oldroyd B fluid?
So Ben Liu at Brown, who used to be in our lab, has been doing some stuff with flagella and Newtonian and viscoelastic fluids. So that kind of stuff is going on, but in this relatively easier case of a rotating flagella. Because there was also an analysis following on the Laudo one by Fu and Powers, where they were looking at the same kind of small amplitude flagella waves and showing people that they were scaling, but then if you had viscoelasticity, you would lose advantage. And I don't know what Ben, I don't want to speak for Ben's results. So yeah, that stuff's going on.
So the Rosenberg number is essentially the ratio of the relaxation time of the polymer in relation to the relaxation time of the fluid, right?
Well, not the relaxation time of the fluid, the forcing time.
The time scale of the fluid. So think about the beat frequency as setting
that
time scale.
Okay, so for an unforced fluid, it will always be infinity. You don't force the fluid anymore.
So you don't force the fluid. Yeah, then it's just a relaxation.
But you're driving.
It would be set by some initial stress.
Some, yeah.
So.
You have a question? Okay. So the title here is supposed to be regularized fluids, regularized doses, but I'm going with the amazing simulations too, and that's really hard to live up to. So I figured that I know that you're at the end of 4 weeks of listening to people who are maybe very excited about what they're talking about, but y'all are tired. So I figured I'd show you some visually appealing things to start with. So one of the projects that I'm working on is joined with two oceanographers at the University of Maine, Pete Umaras and Lee Karp Boss. Pete is more of a physical fluid dynamics oceanographer, and Lee is actually a biologist. And what we want to do is capture the fluid dynamics of phytoplankton, both active and passive structures. And I'll show, so for those of you who've never seen pictures of phytoplankton or thought about them, you might like these. So there are my collaborators on this. Ho Lin is a postdoc at Tulane, and Ricardo Cortez, you'll be hearing a lot about today. He's a colleague in the math department at Tulane, and Ricardo Ortiz was a postdoc. So what are phytoplankton? Phytoplankton are very important. If all the phytoplankton were to disappear, we'd be in big trouble. They are part of the cycle. My words are disappearing. What's the cycle then? Nitrogen? The nitrogen cycle. Yeah, maybe. Okay. So here are diatoms. These are very beautiful. They're basically made of silica. And so here, if we look at Thalassoria, sometimes they come alone, sometimes they come in actual chains. And they are non-motile. But the question is, how do they behave in the living ocean? They only move passively. And the question that Pete and Lee have about these are, what are the functions of these spines? Now, these diatoms are a little bit, they could be a little bit heavier than the fluid around them, and sometimes they could be negatively buoyant. But by and large, we can imagine that they're naturally buoyant. There's some thought that these spines add to the buoyancy and change their sinking speed. Other thoughts are that they act as a defense to larger unicellular organisms that want to eat them. Maybe they don't like the spines. So, but another question is, what is the function of these spines as these diatoms get swirled around the ocean?
How big are they? Sorry.
Let's see. This little bar is 2 microns.
Okay.
So 20 microns more or less. When they come in chains, they're much smaller. I will tell you more. So these are non-motile organisms. If we go up a bit, we'll be looking at dinoflagellates. Dinoflagellates are responsible for red tide. That when you go, any of you gone to Puerto Rico, to Vieques, and you're in the ocean, and then it lights up. There are these fluorescent bays. Those are dinoflagellates. So we'll talk about those in a bit. So our simple question is, how do spines alter the rotational period of a diatom and shear flow? So when you talk to oceanographers, apparently, they let you believe, or they let you believe that it's better for these diatoms to move around more because they would encounter more nutrients in that way. So there's a lot of interest in just how a simple structure gets moved with the surrounding fluid. So now what I'm telling you, what I'm showing you of my false advertising is that I'm going to show you some calculations using an inverse boundary framework where we're solving the Navier-Stokes equations, as I described yesterday. But I just put this in yesterday because I wanted to show you some pretty pictures. So we want to build this diatom, this kind of spaceship-looking thing, out of a bunch of points and springs. So we could spread those forces due to these rigid like springs to the surrounding fluid, and then calculate the dynamics. Now, Mike talked about Jeffrey's equation, yesterday, and Jeffrey in the 1920s looked at what happens to an ellipsoid in a shear flow. So if you take a shear flow and you put a sphere in the center, it'll rotate at a constant speed. But when you take an ellipsoid, it's going to rotate not at a constant speed, because when it's going to spend most of its time horizontal. It's when it flips like this, the velocity differential here and here is bigger, so it'll flip over. So it stays most of the time horizontal. What happens here when you add spines, and this is not an ellipsoid? So there's philosophical question behind all of this. Could we just say this guy here is an ellipsoid and take it from there, look at the ellipsoid that best fits this, and do a back of the envelope, or not even back of the envelope calculation, and try to say what the period of rotation is? Or do we have to go and solve with some sort of fidelity the Navier-Stokes equation? I'm not asking for the answer. Yeah, so you can tell me afterwards. Maybe you'll never know until you do it. So here, we're very lucky to have Hall in our group, who has a finite element background and knows how to grid domains using central Voronoi tessellations. And I'm not going to give you any details here. You start with a sphere, you map it to an ellipse, and you do some other mappings where you map edges to edges, and you do these funny things. So first, like I said, we're going to test our code by putting an ellipsoid in a shear flow. So here's our ellipsoid. What do you see about this ellipsoid?
It's deforming
a little bit. You know, such is life within the Nernst boundary framework. We are not specifying the kinematics, and the way that we specify things is by putting in forces. And these forces, the way that in this rendition, these forces are coming from springs, for instance. So we could tune up the spring stiffness to some point, but we do get some feedback. And the beauty of an immersed boundary framework is that we can easily capture actual elastic structures. Numerically, it's a less stiff problem. Mathematically, it's a harder problem that we can capture. So we do get some deformation, but not much. And again, we have, here's the angle that the vertical makes with this, and we see that we match very well the Jeffrey's. So now let's take something like this spaceship here and put it in a shear flow. You know, these calculations are long. Building the structure is long. Coupling it with the fluid, this here for a complete rotation with this adaptive mesh might have taken 4 days of computation. So, but we figure out its rotational period. So then my question is, how does that differ from just an ellipse? So what ellipse would you use to say that this guy was like? Yeah. So the idea is, let's take this and find the best fit ellipse that circumscribes it. So we did things like this. Here's a structure. We vary the number of spines and the angle of spines and so on. And then we found the best ellipse where the volume of the ellipse minus the volume of the diatom is minimized. And then we put those numbers into the formula of Jeffrey. So what you see here is this. let's just pick out one of these, this green with 12 spines. What you see is, depending upon the spine angle over here, the period of rotation is given here, and the spine angles vary. But in red, what we have is what we would have gotten just by the Jeffries calculation. And so you could interpret this in a few ways. When the spine angles were 0 degrees or straight up and down, that the fluid dynamics is not as well described by the best fit ellipse. But in some of these cases here, we did pretty well. So are the full 3D CFD calculations necessary? Well, maybe in this problem here, not anymore. If you have this number of spines with a reasonable angle. Okay. Here we got very different periods of rotation, not as enhanced here.
So the full 3D are immersed boundary or Stokes?
I'm sorry, these are immersed boundary, but at low Reynolds. So the other observation from the biologists is that, you know, this is interesting, that maybe what spines can do is to achieve motion that's associated with the ellipsoid, but that uses far less biomaterial. So if they want to behave as a bigger ellipsoid, perhaps maybe just grow some spines, and that will give them that same rotational frequency. Okay, so this is also an example, I think, where of interdisciplinary collaboration where as a mathematician, a physicist, you might think, oh, these are going to be really boring calculations. Really, why do I want to spend time doing this? But then there are questions that formulated can give some bio insight. So I didn't really want to go through with these calculations, but Pete and Lee were very, very excited about this. Namely, that, you know, you can achieve the shape change with less biomaterial.
And just in the Jeffrey case, how does the rotational speed scale with the size of the ellipsoid?
Well, you could. The formula involves the shear rate and just the aspect ratio. It's the aspect ratio.
So for same that shape, small and big will probably have the same thing.
Okay, so I wanted to show you that. Great. Okay. So now, take a breath, and I want to quickly talk about the steady Stokes equations. So in the immersed boundary framework, which I showed you, which I've shown you calculations, 2D, 3D, rigid things, passive things, actuated things, what we do is we represent the presence of an immersed structure by a delta function distribution of forces. One could do the same thing in the Stokes equations. So let me just write down X down here. Let's see. Minus or plus the P.
Right?
I can't see that far myself. Okay.
Can I put the lights on?
Yes, the
right
ones. The right ones, the spikes. Down.
Down.
No.
Down.
Down.
The lights.
Stop. I was looking at buttons, not clicking switches.
Yeah, that's
good to know. I got the signs right. So, just to orient you, the question is, what happens if F is little f times a point force? So instead, now let's think of taking the Stokes domain and imparting a finite force at a single point. Okay. So I know that you've gone over the Stokes-Lipp solution, but I want to, but in order to go over regularized Stokes-Lipp, I actually want to just I want to do some calculation. So if you, so how do we compute the fundamental solution to it? Did you go over Stokes-Lipp?
No.
Okay. Good. Then I'm not. This is what I want. I want to know what is the response for the fluid velocity field to a force exerted at one point. And the way we do it is this. So I'm gonna do everything here is gonna be a formal derivation. So let's imagine that I'm in 3D. And I want to know this. I'm using Laplacian like this, probably you guys do L squared. But the Green's function for the Laplacian in three space is what? So the Laplacian of this Green's function would be zero everywhere except at the origin, where we have this delta function. So does anyone know what the Green's function is in 3D for the Laplacian? Okay, this is good. So we're going to look for solutions so that, you know, imagine this is zero here. Now we're imparting a force at a point, and so we expect that we're imparting force at the origin at a single point. So you know the Dirac delta function. So I want to know what the Laplacian of G, I want the Laplacian of G to be this. We should look for radial solutions. So let's look for radial solutions. So the radial Laplacian, I never remember it, but in 3D, it's 1 over r squared times r squared. Somebody agree with me here? A bunch of physicists don't remember the radial Laplacian. You're nodding. You agree with me, right? So if you instead of x, y, z, if you change your coordinates to r, theta, phi, and you get rid of all the theta and phi terms, you get something that looks like this. Okay. So if we're looking for the Green's function g, we put this in here. And let's just imagine that the delta function is zero, so everywhere away from x equals zero. So you solve this, okay? So you multiply by r squared and you integrate, so you're gonna get, forget that r squared, you get r squared, g prime is a constant, and so you get g prime is a constant over r squared. You integrate, you're gonna get another constant over r plus another constant. About some region containing it?
One.
It's one, right? So this is one. Now, what we have here, we can use the divergence theorem, right? So this is divergence of gradient G. And so we use the divergence theorem, and you get that here, this is going to be just dg dn around the surface here. And then you put what g is here. Dg dn is just dg dr, and you get a number from here. And it works out that, so here you put in g equals c tilde over r, and you calculate the surface integral, and what you get is that this constant, I'm not going to go through it with you, that this constant is minus 1 over 4 pi. Right? So that's the Green's function. Let me make sure that I got this right. That's the Green's function for the Laplacian in free space, meaning if you have a delta force as the right-hand side of the Laplacian, you get that. So here, remember this. Okay? Well, let's write R. Okay. Now, what's interesting about this, or what's an important feature? At r equals 0, this is singular. No surprises, right? We had a singular force at 0. Okay. You can then look for the Green's function for the Laplacian of the Laplacian by saying the Laplace, or the Green's function for the biharmonic, and we look for a function such that Laplacian V is G. Right? Because what this tells us is the Laplacian of the Laplacian of B is the delta function. So this is like a fundamental solution for the biharmonic equation. If you go through all of this, you put G here. Right? So you can find B by looking for the Laplacian of B is minus 1 over 4 pi r. You do the same thing. Look for radial solutions. Right, I'm not going to go. Now, this arithmetic is pretty easy. But you integrate, and there's a Laplacian in terms of radial solutions, you get B such that Laplacian B is G. What does this have to do with the Stokes equations? So I want to formally show you how you can find the solution to the Stokes equations by knowing what domain you're in, infinite space in 3D. We could do the same thing in 2D here, but for 3D, what I need to get my solution to the Stokes equations for a point force is the Green's function for the Laplacian and the biharmonic function B such that Laplacian and Laplacian of B is the delta function. And you can do this for homework. So B turns out to be, B is non-singular at the origin, and it is this. So here is B, and here is G. Okay. What the reason that I'm going over this twofold, because I don't want this Stokeslet solution to seem mysterious. It's something that you could or should have calculated at some point and applied that course. But number two, it's an important feature for a numerical method to be able to do this. And so finally, let's go back to the Stokes equations. So I'm going to go back over here. And now here's where I'm going to do things completely formally. And if you're an analyst, you're going to cry when I write things down, but you can fill in all the details that would make it work okay. Okay, divergence of U is 0. I'm going to put my F here as the point force at the origin. I am going to take divergence of the first equation. Okay? The divergence of the Laplacian of U, I'm going to switch orders, that's going to be 0. I get the divergence of the gradient of P is minus the Laplacian of P is equal to let me write it. I'm being God here. This is my, this, let's put F times delta, because the delta is a scalar function, this is, this is scalar. I need a vector here, so this is a vector F. That's my force here. So then this is divergence F delta. So this should scare you, because delta isn't even a function, and I'm not taking more derivatives of it. But then I realize that my delta is just another way of writing Laplacian G. My Green's function in free space. And then I can write by taking my Laplacians out, and then I can write this as my pressure, my scalar pressure field is then my force dotted with the gradient of this Green's function. And we have a handle of this Green's function. Okay, so you should agree that what I've done here, taking divergence and have this construct, this delta function, this is pretty serious stuff. I'm just happily taking more derivatives of it. Okay, but I have my pressure now. But now I want you. So I am going to put this back in here. Okay? And if I put that back in there, I get mu, Laplacian mu is equal to grad F0 dot grad G minus F0, and my delta I'm going to put in as Laplacian of G. Okay, so you should fill in all of these details for homework at some point in your life. Okay. And so now I also realize I'm going to rewrite this as mu Laplacian mu is equal to F dot grad grad G minus F Laplacian G. And now I'm going to take my G. I'm going to take my G and write G as G, Laplacian of B is G. So that my here's my Green's function. I define my biharmonic function as the Laplacian of B is G. Okay. I have a Laplacian here, a Laplacian here, a Laplacian here. I will take it out. So this is where, you know, this is where your analysts should be crying. But so we got mu times u is equal to F dot grad gradient of B minus F times the Green's function. Okay, u better be a vector. B is the scalar function, its gradient is a vector. F dot grad will give you a vector. Okay, this is it. This is the solution. Now, if I guess during Mike's talk yesterday, I did all the arithmetic with my B and G to make sure I got U, and you two can do it. But you would get, then, if you put in what the definition of your Green's function and your biharmonic function is for, in terms of not R, but X, Y, and Z, what you come up with is the Stokes-Slip solution, and I will write it down for you. You get 1 over 8 pi times your vector F over R plus F dotted with X scalar times the direction X over R. So this is the Stokes-Slip. And you too can calculate it. Let's look at what this means. This is the response. response in 3D, no boundaries, of the fluid velocity field to a point force with direction F applied at the origin. We have two pieces here. Feel like I made a mark. This is F, sorry. F makes me much happier. Okay. You get one response, one piece of the solution. If you force in this direction, a piece of the solution is parallel to that direction, F over R. But because of if you force this way, the whole fluid can't be moving in that way because it's incompressible. You have to have some flow going in another direction. And this piece here is not pointing in the direction of that. You can visualize what this flow field looks like. The other thing is this, it's got a 1 over R singularity. What this does is that if you put a force at the origin, you're going to feel the effect on the fluid flow order 1 over R away. It does die off. It dies off like 1 over R. And here you have some of the higher order terms. Unfortunately, it is singular. So when you apply a force at R equals 0, your velocity field, your velocity at R equals 0 is infinite. So numerically, you can compute the response to a single force applied at the origin or at any point by shifting this, but you cannot compute the velocity at that point. It's infinite. So the whole idea with the more refined models that we've been looking at in Mars boundary model and so on, we have a structure that's going to apply force. We're going to solve the fluid equations, figure out the velocity then at those points, and update the position. We cannot use this formula directly because the place where we are applying force is giving us a velocity that's not finite. Okay? We can integrate this and things are okay, and this is the basis of boundary integral methods and so on. But what I wanted to do was to show you the classical calculation, even in this formal manner, that you do get. Okay. Suppose that singularity did not bother you. If you have a bunch of forces, if you had a force at the origin, plus a force somewhere else, plus a force somewhere else, because the Stokes equations are linear, your solution would just be a sum of these Stokes loads. That's the beauty of linearity. So what I want to do now, and I'll show you in the next few minutes, I have how this is a basis of a very pretty numerical method, and I'll show you some simulations of it. I'll probably have to show them to you next time. Now, if we did this whole exercise in 2D, does anyone know what this Stokes looks like in 2D? It's log. So it's log R, which I find completely unappealing. Because there's something wrong about that, because if you put the leading term is log R, and if you put a force at x equals 0, it's not dying off at infinity. And then you get your Stokes paradox and other things. So if you're going to use Stokes equations, you should go directly to 3D where things make more sense. So now, what I'm going to tell you is this.
Excuse me? Sorry? Yeah. Isn't it more or less that you have a Dirichlet boundary condition?
All right, so now I have no boundaries.
Right.
In real life, we do have boundaries, but the boundaries that we're going to be looking at are somehow immersed in three space. So here's how you would fix things. This construction relied on knowing your Green's function for the Laplacian. You could do that if you put an infinite plane wall by method of images. If you had periodic boundary conditions, you could do things like Ewald summation. So this is classical applied math. Like how many are boundary of the sphere? You could do a mapping and this sort of thing. But coming up with these formulas for general boundaries it would all have to be numerical. Okay, so let me see. So I will tell you instead of going onto the computer here, what the method of regularized spoke slip is. And this is one thing that I find very appealing looking at biological problems. If you like sharp interfaces, you won't find this appealing. But the deal is that the delta function, the Dirac delta function, where you exert force at a single point, is a construct, right? So you can't really exert finite force at a zero-dimensional point. So rather than looking at the delta function as this wholly correct thing where you have an infinitesimal support, instead what we look at is what happens if you regularize that delta function, which I contend is more physical, and instead of looking at the delta function, look at applying a force concentrated at the origin, but spread out. So here, where this is some log function. Now, this framework, this methodology put forth as a numerical method was originally due to my colleague Ricardo Cortez, and he has some nice notes that I asked be put up for you on this. So I took his notes on the homework step because I had to minimize the amount of work that I actually did. But the deal is this. Rather than taking the delta function, we look at these log functions where we have the integral of phi epsilon. I think he calls them phi delta in his notes, but I'm using epsilon here, where the integral is 1. And these are approximations to, you know, the delta function, where here these are going to be radial, or they're going to be symmetric. I'm drawing this in 1D. But what you look at are things like this, where as the parameter epsilon goes to 0, you get more and your concentration is more and more at that point. Okay. So I can see this in my screen, but you can't see it on yours. So for instance, if we choose phi epsilon to be something like this, 15 epsilon, my vision is really bad, epsilon to the fourth over 8 pi times r squared plus epsilon squared to the 7/2 for epsilon non-zero, you can agree that, so here this is radial, it's concentrated near the origin, this has integral 1. But this, you wouldn't just pull this out of a hat. This has some nice properties, and for people who have looked at mollifiers and at vortex methods and so on, where you want to look at approximations to delta functions, you too could come up with many different forms for these. But the beauty is that you can go through all of the steps that I just went through for a well-chosen radial delta function like this, a radial log function. You can look at, instead of finding the Laplacian of g equal the delta function, you could find the Laplacian of g equal phi epsilon. You can find a Green's function analytically by doing a couple of integrations. Of course, for a fixed approximate function. You could similarly find your regularized biharmonic function. And then you could find your regularized Stokes slip. And so this is where I'm going to be heading next time, and I think it's just actually worth writing down for you to give you the upshot here. And for this choice of function, the resulting velocity field is 1 over 8 pi. You could look at your formula, you could see you have 1 over r is 1 over r cubed, you don't like that. And then you could just shove in an epsilon. Instead of having an r in the denominator, you put r plus epsilon, or you put the square root of r squared plus epsilon squared. You do that regularization after the fact. Here, the regularization is not done after the fact. What we have here is an exact solution to the Stokes equations, okay? That is incompressible. Where the regularization occurred was in the interpretation of the problem. We said, what is the response to not a point force, but a regularized force, where the support is basically radius epsilon. So one could think about that epsilon as some inherent thickness of the boundary, or could think of it as a physical parameter. You go through all these calculations, and there's nothing numerical that I wrote down so far. I have a parameter epsilon that I'll be free to choose. But the good news is that I have a solution to the Stokes equations for a force that is concentrated at the origin, but not only felt at the origin. So here's my parameter epsilon. You can see when I set it to zero, I get back my first. I get back the classic solution, but we are going to use this now in a very simple way, because we're going to have a collection of forces representing our inner structure, and we can, based upon those forces, we can just compute the velocity at all of the points with this just direct application of. There's a couple of issues that will come up, and tomorrow I will show you some amazing simulations with regular systems. Okay, thanks.
Yes.
Just one on the denominator, that phi function there, is that 3 over 2 or 7 over 2?
7. Now, Ricardo Cortez has this, he's got this religious association with blobs. He can manufacture one after another. He has some favorites. This is one of his favorites. These aren't, so in the notes you will see what's important about blobs. You know that when you integrate a function against the delta function, you should just get f at 0. So if you integrate this approximate delta function against a function, you'll get some other terms. You want to knock out some of those moments. So you get more accuracy depending upon how many moments get knocked out. Okay, so it's not. This is not just artwork. There's analysis that goes into it.
Okay, thanks, Lisa.